Friends, welcome to the 177th Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. As the journey continues, we have been exposed to different facets of law, nuances of law, and we have been having in-depth analysis in the last 176 sessions. Today, in the 177th session, we have a wonderful speaker. Special thanks to Dr. Amit George for getting us this wonderful speaker, Krishnaswamy Parameshwar, and we are privileged with the presence of Justice Ramkumar, sir, and all of you wonderful participants. And this being a thoroughly informal platform wherein what matters is only legal discussions and deliberations, we are not wasting time on anything. Directly over to you, Dr. Amit George, for the introductory remarks.
Right. Thank you, Shyam, sir. So I have a slight predicament doing the introductory remarks today, because I really don't know much about the topic. So if I talk too much on it, it will probably embarrass the speaker going forward. Corresponding problem is I know so much about the speaker that once again, if I speak too much, it will again end up embarrassing the speaker, my good friend, Mr. Parameshwar. So I would obviously want to hand over the stage to him as soon as possible. But before doing that, I think this topic today, which Mr. Parameshwar will be addressing on us, is obviously something of great contemporary relevance. Federalism has always remained one of the great fault lines, if I may call it, in our polity. And this is one topic which we learn about, we hear about much before we even enter into, say, the portals of law school. Of course, our understanding of federalism at a nascent stage is one which is strictly defined by, say, a division of powers. We talk about it in a very formalistic sense. You have the union list, the state list, the concurrent list. It's put out in very stark terms. But the nuances that this particular topic engenders, the kind of conceptualizations that it has, it's quite remarkable. So I'm sure it'll be very interesting to listen to Parameshwar today. But in terms of some of the more interesting ways in which federalism has been defined, I remember Dr. Ambedkar's view of how he saw federalism as enshrined in the Indian Constitution as saying that it was more of a federal state in normal times of peace. Whereas if it was a state of war, then it was more of a unitary system. Now, of course, in the particular context in which the statement was made, there is nothing wrong with that statement, but it's a bit ominous when one puts it into the contemporary day and age. Another interesting conceptualization is, of course, by Justice Begg, who in the 1970s in a judgment referred to the constitution in this regard as being amphibian in nature, as something which was, let's say, tuned to being both as the situation would demand it. Then, of course, you've had subsequent Supreme Court judgments stressing on the fact that overall the Constitution does have a unitary sort of like a lean, though ultimately it does represent an overall rubric of cooperative federalism. So, well, beyond the normative or beyond the jurisprudential theories, we all know how important an understanding of what exactly are the powers of the union or the state are on the ground level. Almost all the issues of contemporary relevance in terms of, say, more controversial legislations, all effectively are answered by this very question as to what is the true scope of the federal nature of our constitution. So therefore, I mean, there really can't be more of a gainsaying as to how important this topic is today. And therefore, I think we are very privileged to have Mr. Parameshwar with us here. Mr. Parameshwar practices before the Supreme Court of India and at a very relatively young age has already had the privilege of addressing and assisting the bench on matters of significant importance, various important reported judgments to his credit, as also he's had the privilege of being appointed amicus by the Supreme Court in various matters. On a personal level, I am sure many generations of students from NALSAR have graduated in constitutional law thanks to the notes prepared by Mr. Parameshwar, which are obviously in high demand. So therefore, I'm sure that same felicity and let's say sharing of knowledge, which he's demonstrated throughout law school, will be reflected today here as well. So therefore, with that, I request Parameshwar to kindly take over. Thank you.
Thank you, Amit. That was just wonderful. Over to you, Parmeshwar. All is.
Let me begin by thanking the organizers for calling me to speak in this webinar. I have resisted the temptation of speaking in a webinar since the pandemic broke. And I'm glad I am doing my first webinar towards the end, I think, when the pandemic is coming to a close. So when Amit asked me what topic I wanted to speak on, I said, let me do something about federalism. I know it can't be as structured in a small time frame. I can't cover a lot of topics, but I just wanted to throw up some ideas and some questions in order to understand the relevance of federalism. Amit was part of the conversation when another friend asked me, why are you speaking on federalism? Isn't it dead? I said, I don't know whether I'm doing an obituary for federalism, but I'm hoping that it doesn't come to that. There are very many ways in one in which one can understand federalism. You can call it a strong center, federalism with a strong central bias. You can call it a unitary structure, the Constitution of India. You could talk about it in terms of asymmetric federalism, in the sense that not all federating units have a similar power or bargaining power in the constitutional structure or in the way in which they work the Constitution. You could call it asymmetric in that nature. You could talk about in terms of distinguishing between holding together and coming together federalism. Coming together federalism being when the constituting units make a very informed and very very rational choice about how they will pull together their powers and constitute themselves into a federal unit. Or you could talk about it in terms of a holding together federal system, where the center's role is more to hold together the federating units and nothing more. So the characterization or the nomenclature is not something that I want to get into today, because there will be problems if you try to classify the Constitution federal characteristics one way or the other. But if we are to understand the way in which we have worked this Constitution for ourselves, then I would like to point out about 8 or 9 issues around which, or 8 or 9 characteristics of the Constitution, and the way in which these 8 or 9 have played out in the last 70-75 years. The first and the most obvious, I think, is the power to create and destroy states. Now, you might wonder why I use the term destroy states, but it's not a term that I have tried to use in this context. It is the words of Chief Justice Sinha when he said that the Indian Constitution permits the center to even destroy states, a remarkable term that was used in the 60s by Sinha, Justice Sinha, in state of West Bengal versus Union of India, that case which defined the prominent characteristics of the Indian Federation. And that has been so true. The latest example one can see with Jammu Kashmir. Prior to that, with the formation of Telangana, where against the wishes of a resolution passed by the Telangana Assembly, the Andhra Pradesh Assembly, saying that they are not for bifurcation, yet the center went ahead with the bifurcation of the state into Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. So what I wanted to, the remark that I wanted to make here, dehorse the text, dehorse the powers that they may enjoy, the parliament may enjoy in terms of creation and division of states. The way in which the Supreme Court has supported this power, starting from Justice Sinha's opinion, then Bhagulal Parate onwards, saying that the resolution passed by the state assembly when the process of bifurcation is on or splitting is on is not at all mandate binding on the parliament. From there onwards, we can see that the creation and bifurcation of states and union territories is completely at the mercy of the center. So that is so far as the power to create and destroy states are concerned. So we've seen how it has been used. to the Constitution itself as it was enacted, didn't create equal power centers within states itself. What it did was it created pockets of autonomy. So it created the fifth schedule, it created the sixth schedule. Till recently, it also, the case of Jammu Kashmir. So the very, from its very beginning, the Constitution contemplated that the federating units would not be equal in terms of the power and the autonomy they enjoyed. So that that feature continues through today itself, today also. So you still have larger greater autonomy within the fifth schedule and the sixth schedule areas. The state's power otherwise than the fifth and sixth schedule areas have largely been eroded over the last 70 years, but the fifth schedule and the sixth schedule powers almost remain intact even today. So the second feature, as I said, would be pockets of autonomy. The third feature of the Constitution is the way in which the states came together from different backgrounds, in the sense that there were princely states, there were states which were directly under the British rule, there were states which were under different colonial powers, there were union territories which were under different colonial powers. All these came together, but within 6 years of these diverse federating units coming together, you superimpose on them a linguistic, classification. So the reorganization that happened on linguistic basis, something perhaps not even contemplated by the Constitution in its text, created its own problems. So as I said, power to create and destroy states, to the pockets of autonomy that the Constitution created. Third, the superimposition of language as the criteria for classifying geographical units within the country. Now, that brought its own set of problems. So, different cultures, states with different cultures had to be, same cultures had to be split up only on linguistic basis. We had territories that came to be disputed, especially among these southern states, dispute of territories between Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, went on for quite some time. The other problem was judicial administration and executive administration in these states were very, very different prior to the reorganization of states on linguistic basis. So what happened was you ended up amalgamating cultures, peoples, and administrative units of different varieties into a single state for the first time after the States Reorganization Act. So that brought its own set of problems. And you will see the echoes of, the after effect of those problems, for example, when two constitutional provisions that many people may not even know exist in the Constitution. One is 371D and one is 371J. 371D is the product of creation of a Telugu-speaking state, and thereafter the after effects of mismanagement or lack of development in certain pockets of the state. So 371D came to be created to take care of certain parts of the Andhra state, and there were special provisions for administering that state, 371D. Very recently for the Hyderabad Karnataka region, again, because they were under the erstwhile Nizam rule, 371J came to be introduced. I think it's even after 2003 or 2004, that provision came to be introduced. So you see the way the Constitution is working itself is that you are seeing the aftershocks of a linguistic classification being imposed, and that classification resulting in developmental issues within the states or representational issues within the state. And to address that, you keep amending the Constitution to give some more autonomy or give special status or special provisions for those areas. So that is 371D, 371J. The other feature, which is very, very interesting so far as the Indian constitution is concerned, is a feature that is not a product of the text of the constitution, but a product of the politics of this nature, of this nation. That is the result of, that is the one party rule in this country for about 2.5 decades until about the imposition of the emergency. Now, the first 25 years of this republic, you see a ready reckoner for this is to see the Supreme Court judgments on federalism between 1950 and 1975. And you will actually find very few mention of the word, hardly any mention of the word federalism or discussion of the Supreme Court judgments till 50 to 75, because no serious federalism issues were raised except, I think, State of West Bengal versus Union of India. And that too came because of acquisition of land, not because the state and the union had serious issues on a larger principle or scope of the understanding of the nature of federalism under the Indian constitution. So long the country was under a one-party rule, there was no effective, healthy confrontation that happened so as to, for us to develop principles of federalism or understand these issues. So that feature of our polity, that we were under a single party rule for about 25 years, where inter-party democracy had a direct bearing on federalism. Lack of an inter-party democracy, or lack of, one may say, regional leaders powerful enough to voice their concerns, perhaps also affected the way in which the constitutional understanding of federalism was structured. So until there were serious disputes in the 70s and 80s about imposition of precedence rule, etc., the idea of federalism was not very clearly articulated even by the courts, because there weren't actually that many disputes that came. So the unique feature of how our law on federalism developed also is a product of the single party rule for 25 years until the imposition of the emergency. And only thereafter will you see the articulation of federalism as an issue. The next feature, or the next point in relation to federalism, one could think of, is the Council of States, the Rajya Sabha. I know I'm the way in which I'm articulating my thoughts on federalism is not the textbook variety, in the sense that we are not doing administrative relations. Look at the list, see legislative relations, financial relations. But I thought we should look at it from a little broader perspective so that we understand not just the text of the constitution, but how we have worked our constitutional institutions and the constitutions itself in the context of federalism. So if you look at the Rajya Sabha as an institution, the way in which we worked that institution out has serious consequences on our understanding of federalism. If you see the constitutional text itself, the Rajya Sabha, or the Council of States, unlike the Lok Sabha, there is no constitutional mandate that the Rajya Sabha must have the state's representation in the Rajya Sabha must be proportional to the population. It's a very crucial distinction that not many appreciate. Whereas the constitution has clear textual provisions on how the number of constituencies in each state and thereby the number of members in the parliament will have will be in proportion to the population. Of course, there is a freezing of the census on which census that numbers will be dictated, etc. But so far as the Rajya Sabha is concerned, the constitutional provision merely says will be as is reflected in the fourth schedule. There are no parameters given on the constitution as to how the number of seats in the Rajya Sabha must be calculated for each state. So there is a schedule, and the schedule, there are numbers attached to it. What has been happening over the years is that we also drew parallels from the Lok Sabha and the state legislative assemblies, and on the basis of population, attempted to define the number of seats each state will have in the Raj Sabha. A consequence of which is there are states with one or two members in the Raj Sabha. So even in the Council of States, the smaller states do not get adequate representation. In the Lok Sabha, it could have been, one can understand why it is in proportional, why it is proportionate to the population of the state itself. In the Raj Sabha, like the US Senate, where every state sends an equal number of senators to the US Senate, the Raj Sabha, the way we have worked itself out is we again discriminate on the basis of the size of the states. Thereby, the voice of the smaller states is relatively unheard in the parliament. That is the first problem with the way in which the Council of States is run in this country. The second concern in which the on the manner in which we have run the Council of States is that earlier the Representation of People's Act had a provision saying that if you had to be from the if you had to get elected from Rajya Sabha from a particular state, you had to be a domicile of that state. That provision was amended and that requirement was taken away sometime in the year 2002-2003, leading to the challenge in the Supreme Court in Kuldeep Nair versus Union of India. Now the Supreme Court rejected the challenge and said that perhaps it has an effect on federalism. Agreed that federalism is a basic structure, but we can't strike down this amendment, taking away the requirement of domicile on that basis. And it upheld the amendment. Thereby, what happened that it was nominally called a Council of States. You did not have the power, every state did not have an equal voice in the Council of States. Now, technically, a state needn't even be represented by a person belonging to that state. So that's how we have now reduced Rajya Sabha to be an seniors accommodative house for the parliament, or a backdoor entry for businessmen or nominated people to come into the parliament. The actual purpose of having a Council of States, whereby the concerns of the respective states would be aired, discussed, debated, that entire purpose is now lost so far as the Raj Sabha is concerned. Added to this misery that how we make the Rajya Sabha irrelevant is the Supreme Court's stand on money bills. The way in which the Supreme Court has articulated what a money bill, that was the only area of concern where the Rajya Sabha could have weighed in its opinion and make its presence felt. The unfortunate manner in which the Supreme Court has articulated the law around money bills and the necessity for it to be placed in the Rajya Sabha, unfortunately, that has dented federalism also. So we've made the Rajya Sabha almost irrelevant today in this fashion. It does not end there. The Rajya Sabha is made irrelevant, and perhaps federalism to a great extent made irrelevant also because of the manner in which the 10th schedule operates in the Constitution. Now, one must understand the gravity of the situation. Now, the Constitution doesn't talk about a right to vote. Unfortunately, our Supreme Court also suggests that a citizen in this country does not have a constitutional right to vote, because the Constitution in so many terms does not grant it. There have been some sparkling dissent opinions saying that no, it has to be a constitutional right, perhaps even a fundamental right under 19(1)A of the Constitution. But the majority, the settled law of this country is that a citizen does not have a constitutional right to vote in this democracy. That being said, we imposed on ourselves the 10th schedule of the Constitution, for the first time recognizing the concept of a political party within the Constitution. what was only there in the Representation of People's Act, etc., for the first time after 40 years of the Constitution, we brought the concept of a political party into the Constitution. And the way in which the Supreme Court upheld the 10 scheduled provisions as constitutional, saying that it is necessary for stability that a legislator or a member of parliament or an assembly does not violate the party whip. That out of the two, when we balance, the greater good is for the stability of the government. What it did was completely sacrifice the right to vote and the right of conscience of a legislature to the larger purpose of a political party and the political whip. In effect, what happens is, even in houses where, for example, the Council of States, even in or the legislative councils in some states, where the continuance of a government does not matter because the strength of the government has to be only proved in the Lok Sabha or the assembly, there also today legislators are bound by the party whip. They are bound by the party whip, not just on the budget, rather on a finance bill or on the vote of confidence or a vote of no confidence. They are bound by the party whip because of the interpretation of the 10th schedule on every whip that the party issues, from a Panchayati Raj Amendment Act to any small discussion, which has virtually rendered a individual parliamentarian's vote completely negatory. So if the party today takes a stand, whether it is in the interest of his constituency, whether it is in the interest of the candidates, parliamentarian state, there is no way but to vote by the party line. So today, your constitution doesn't give you a right to vote. It doesn't protect the right to vote of your elected member, but the constitution, by the 10th schedule and the emphasis the Supreme Court places on the rigorous implementation of the 10th schedule, has elevated the political party as the pivot of the Indian democracy, not the voter, not your elected representative. So if the political party's interests are not aligned with the state's interest, there is no way that federalism can work in this country. So that is the other feature that we, the way the constitution works, the other feature in other manner in which we whittled down what little rights the states had in this constitution. Rajya Sabha, one institution. The other institution which the constitution envisaged, and we did not constitute for the first 40 years of our republic, is the Interstate Council. Now, the Interstate Council under Article 263 of the Constitution, I think, was a mechanism where disputes between states or concerns, mutual concerns between states and concerns between the center and the state could have been addressed. There was a ready-made constitutional provision right there. And if the council was constituted, perhaps we would have had a very healthy debate and a very healthy federal system. But because of the single party rule, as I say, and because we had a politically very strong center, the Interstate Council was constituted for the first time in 1990 or 1991. That is after the Sarkaria commissions were accepted. And since 1990 or 1991, the council has met only 11 times. The last meeting, I think, is in 2016. 11 meetings for an Interstate Council constituted after 40 years of the Republic and in 70 years of its functioning. So the Interstate Council is irrelevant. So this was accompanied by creating non-constitutional, non-statutory bodies to undertake economic and planning decisions in this country. The Planning Commission, created through a office memorandum and later now replaced by the Niti Aayog. What you did was the entirety of how our economy had to be planned was shifted to non-statutory, non-constitutional bodies while you were making the Rajya Sabha irrelevant, while you were refusing to make even constitute the Interstate Council. And these two bodies assumed virtually the role of planning for the states as well. Now, economic and social planning is a matter on the concurrent list. Therefore, it legitimized the action of these bodies. But the interesting part is, if you see the executive power of the center under the constitution, it can apply to a state only if there is a law mandating that. So far as a state is concerned, the executive power is coextensive with legislative power. The center's executive power is coextensive with its legislative power. But if the center's executive power has to apply to the territory of a particular state, then there must be a law backing it. Unfortunately, in this country, without the Planning Commission being a statutory body or the Niti Aayog being a statutory body, the entirety of social and economic planning for this country is being undertaken without the backing of a central law, authorizing the executive to undertake, the union executive to undertake economic and social planning so far as the states are concerned. But that is how we have made our constitutional and statutory institutions redundant, but empowered executive institutions like the Planning Commission and the Niti Aayog. The other way in which federalism got affected in this country was that the constitution envisaged the creation of a unified judiciary in this country. Or at least that is how we understand it. But there are two crucial points that one might want to note in this regard. One, the administrative and superintending control of the subordinate courts is given to the High Court. But no such power is essentially granted to the Supreme Court in respect of the High Courts. A holistic reading of the Constitution, to my understanding, creates the High Courts and Supreme Court as constitutional courts, where a High Supreme Court may not issue directions to a High Court in that sense. But the way in which we have worked ourselves out is because the appointments are controlled by the Supreme Court over the years. The concentration on the power of appointments has come to be vested with the Supreme Court. It seems as if we have a unified judiciary. But In that sense, it is not, because the high courts are not answerable to the Supreme Court in a big way, because there is no superintending administrative power that the Constitution confers on the Supreme Court. So that is another aspect of federalism. If you talk about justice delivery, although the majority of offenses, legal rights, dispute settlement mechanisms are created by central acts. The burden of the subordinate judiciary and the High Court is completely on the state exchequer and not on the central exchequer. Article 247 of the Constitution, which says that the center may take on the burden of establishing courts, hardly ever used in the Indian Constitution. So what happens is, in the absence of proper judicial impact assessment, a number of central, 138 is the best example, that you create an offense of 138 and let the state judiciary fend for itself in trying to address the concerns coming out of the dishonor of check cases within the state judiciary. So the union doesn't assume direct responsibility, at least on paper, for the setting up, management and the funding of these courts. So that is the other unique feature of how we worked our federalism out, because we needn't understand federalism only in terms of legislative and administrative relations, but also on how it impacts justice delivery in this country. So in one sense, the union, apart from creating laws and rules, on the implementation or the responsibility part, assumes no role on paper or in terms of any legal legally binding instrument. What comes is by way of charity from the union government. For a long time, for 56 years, judiciary was not even part of the planned expenditure budget when the planning commission was doing it. So everything from diplomatic relations, you would have planned expenditure for foreign dignitaries when they come, you would have planned expenditure for how much money should be set aside for their official visits. But for 50 years, we didn't have planned expenditure for the judiciary. So that is the other feature of federalism which I wanted to point out. The most important factor with most important development so far as federalism in this country is concerned, as far as I am concerned, is how gradually all the revenue earning entries in the state list started migrating towards list 1 and list 3. And how expenditure entries remained intact in the state list. So this is of some concern. So if you see the taxation increase under the constitution as it originally stood, there were a lot of powers, a lot of entries with respect to taxation in the state list. Your sales tax, etc., everything came under the state's power. But over the last 60 years, again, this is a fascinating study of how many constitutional amendments have only come in relation to one sometimes tends to overlook them. The number of amendments that have been made to taxation entries in the constitution, defining what's a sale, what's not a sale, who can tax, who cannot tax. It's a fascinating study. So gradually what you have done is to concentrate taxing power in the hands of the in the center. Now that is sealed with the enactment of the GST. Now, the state has virtually no powers of taxation today. The primary source of state's revenue today, at least on paper, on what remains out of taxation is property tax and land revenue. Apart from that, alcohol and petroleum products, thanks to the peace that was brokered in the GST Council. Otherwise, there is virtually no source of taxation and revenue so far as the state is concerned. So that's a huge development. One would have expected more taxation powers to come. Devolution of taxation powers didn't happen, whereas concentration of taxation powers happened under how we worked our constitution out. Now, the GST itself is a fascinating constitutional analysis for this reason. What it did was, on paper, the amendment says 246A. The amendment says, so far as the goods and services taxes are concerned, the union and the state will have co-equal powers, except for international taxation. But what the same amendment did was to create a GST council. Now, the council is to advise the respective governments on what will be taxed and what will not be taxed, and at what rates to be taxed. So what you have effectively done today is what was a legislative power of taxation at the hands of the state or the center is now subordinated to the GST council. So there is a council today which will now tell the legislature what to tax, what not to tax. Although the text of the article that envisages this creation of the GST Council doesn't say that the recommendation is binding, but the manner in which it has been worked over the past 4 years, ever since it has been established in 2016, shows us that it is the GST Council which decides what will be taxed and at what rates it will be taxed. So legislative power is now being subordinated to the decision that is going to be arrived at a GST Council. Now, in the GST Council, 1/3 of the voting power is given to the center. The quorum is only half for any valid recommendation to be carried. So not only is a state's power now subject to a 1/3 voting power of the center, but a federating unit's voting rights is also subjected to other federating, what the other federating units think. So what was initially under the constitution a state's power to tax commodity X today is not just subject to one-third voting power of the center, but it is also subject to what other states think should be your power with respect to that commodity, how much to tax or whether to tax at all. So the gradual decrease in the revenue earning powers of the state is a remarkable feature of this constitution. Because the states are gradually losing the power of revenue, they start depending heavily on devolution of funds from the center, which is decided by the Finance Commission. Now, one would normally expect that something as serious as devolution of finances in a constitutional democracy where states' power to tax is gradually getting eroded to be based on legislative action. The Finance Commission is not answerable legislatively either to the parliament or to the assembly. So the devolution today of what each state gets is based upon the recommendations of the Finance Commission, whose members are completely appointed by the center. So effectively, you have lost out the power of taxation in so far as what you get from devolution of funds from the center. No elected bodies have a say other than the central government. So that is the other unique feature of how we have worked federalism out for ourselves. The last feature which I wanted to say, perhaps a very important feature also of federalism that I wanted to discuss today, was how, because of a single party rule, perhaps we have never made a noise about this, there are a number of entries in the state list, not in the concurrent list, in the state list, which would have been ordinarily the exclusive domain of the state, where the entirety of policy making is with the center. Three examples I can give. Local government is an entry in the state list, but you have an overarching Panchayati Raj ministry under the center, which effectively formulates all major policies on local self-government institutions in this country. So you have a Panchayati Raj ministry. Under the text of the constitution, the executive power of the union is limited to the list one entries or list three entries, but local self-government institutions are list two. But we do not know how miraculously over the years this ministry has survived. Health ministry. Health is in the state list, but every major policy decision, as this pandemic has shown us, is taken by the center. So health is another entry. Agriculture. Again, we are seeing agriculture is an entry in the state list. Virtually everything about agriculture, from taxing agriculture, is in the state list. But you have a very strong central ministry which takes care of agricultural policies, fertilizer subsidies. Everything is run from the center. Food processing, again, center, although effectively it should have been a state. So the manner in which over 40, 50 years, the center managed to take control of certain subject areas, although the constitution did not allocate those subject areas to the center exclusively, not even exclusively, even concurrently, those subjects were not given to the center by the constitution. The union has effective control. So you have taxing powers coming down. Most of your social economic policies being mandated by the union, because education, health, agriculture, local self-government, everything is run by the center almost entirely. I admit that there are local Panchayati Raj acts, etc. But that is what I am coming to my next point. What has become of federalism in this country is the states have become only implementing units, not decision-making units in that sense. So every major policy decision today including the way in which we acceded to the WTO regime without consultation with the states, how we accepted structural adjustment reforms under the WTO regime, contrary to state rights. Everything is run by the center. What is left of federalism today is that the states have become only implementing units and not decision-making units in that sense. The only two areas I see that are relatively untouched is land, which thankfully the union has not encroached upon yet. Apart from acquisition, there are no major laws on how land is to be regulated in this country by the union. That's why you will see the entirety of agricultural reforms, agricultural ceiling, urban land ceiling act, the land reforms act, all basically a state effort, not primarily a union effort. Land and water, apart from water pollution. Land and water is what primarily now remains with the state in terms of relative federalism. Water pollution has been ceded under the Water Pollution Act, the way in which it was enacted under Article 248 or 252 or 248, where the states resolved to cede that power to the parliament. Pollution went away, but most of the other powers with respect to water today remains with the state. So far as I said, that states today continue to remain as only implementing authorities, the other major area is environment. All your environmental legislations, policies are structured, manufactured from the center. We have only whatever devolution of powers for namesake those legislations do to Panchayati Raj institutions or state level bodies are only for implementational purposes. Policy level, nothing has happened. I can give you an example so far as environment is concerned is after the Coca-Cola disaster in Palakkad, the state passed the Plachimada Compensation Tribunal Act, which the president refused to give assent on the grounds that there was already a Water Pollution Act. And once you cede power with respect to pollution and claims arising from water pollution, to the center when the Water Act was enacted, you could no longer have a tribunal that would compensate, look into claims and compensation for water pollution within the state. So the point I'm trying to make here is on all major areas, as I said, environment, electricity, health, education, food, agriculture, disability, trade and commerce, mines and minerals, factories, the center occupies the field, so to say. There is very little elbow room apart from implementation that the states have left. The last institution, and I deliberately call this an institution, the institution that could have perhaps brought in some more federal values to the decisions that we took was the Office of the President of India. Under Article 254, when state laws conflict with center laws, the president can give assent and those laws will continue to operate, state laws will continue to operate. That's a call of the president. On a number of bills on the parliament on affecting federalism, the president is the key man. On president's rule in the state, the president takes the call. But unfortunately, the way in which, again, we have worked out the institution of the president is that he is not able to, the office of the president is not able to function as a voice of the states, unfortunately. The governor, I needn't say anything more, we all know how governors function in this country, but the president would have been an ideal ideal institution for airing federal concerns, but unfortunately we don't seem to work that institution also in favor of the state's rights. The office of the president, one must understand, is the only office under the constitution which is tasked with preserving, protecting and defending the constitution. If you see the oath of the president, if you see all the oaths in the constitution, the only oath that is mentioned in the text, the main text of the constitution, is the oath of the president. All the other oaths taken by, including the Chief Justice, Council of Ministers, Prime Ministers, are in Schedule 2. And it is only the president who takes the oath to preserve, protect, and defend the constitution. All the others only swear allegiance to the constitution. So if the president's office were to actually preserve, protect, and defend the constitution, in the sense of protecting states' rights, I think there lies enormous possibilities for articulating states' rights if the president were to exercise his constitutionally given powers. That is so far as the office of the president is concerned. The last point I wanted to make was with respect to law and order. We keep reading in textbooks of constitutional law as how law and order is a state subject exclusively within the domain of the states. One of the foundational understandings of the foundational powers of the state, we say in this constitution, is police powers. But unfortunately, because criminal law is in list 3, substantive offense and criminal procedure is in list 3, and only execution of police investigation and police activities in list 2. Again, all major decision, policy making, creation of offenses are all subject to central laws. So what you have today is only the executive act of investigating and punishing people. But what should be an offense, whether you need offense for your respective states, territories, the field is occupied by the center. You will be able to, states will be able to make amendments only if the center gives, the president gives consent. So in that sense too, if you think that the state actually has police powers, it might not be as enormous as one envisages it to be. In effect, actually, what is left is only execution powers. Thanks to the Supreme Court for invocation of the CBI's jurisdiction, you don't need the state's consent. The courts have held that if courts have to order a CBI inquiry, you don't need to get the consent of the state. So virtually, so far as the investigation part also, today, without the state's consent, you could bring in the CBI through a judicial action, even though the state has not given consent under Section 6 and 7 of the Delhi Police Establishments Act. So, on an overall perspective, see what the rights of the states are. We have lost taxing powers drastically. Socioeconomic planning has completely been concentrated in the hands of the center. Even with respect to entries which are not, which were originally in the state list, the union, we have ceded by a working of the constitution, not through a constitutional amendment, but the working of the constitution, we have ceded those powers completely to the center. Institutions that should have protected the federal character of our constitution, we don't work them well. We have vested powers in extra constitutional bodies, so to speak, to do planning, economic and social planning for this country. The Rajya Sabha, we have made it irrelevant. The Council of States doesn't function. And the 10th schedule doesn't permit our elected representative to effectively articulate a state's concern in the parliament. So in a nutshell, it's not just a mere constitution with a strong unitary bias. I think every moment we are trying to gravitate towards a unitary constitution. So that's my thoughts on federalism. Thank you
very much, Parmeshwar sir. Directly over to you, Ramkumar sir, for your thoughts on this.
Thank you, Ram. Excellent articulation on federalism. For a confirmed criminal like me, all that I know about federalism is I used to be the head of the family in my ration card. Even that power has been taken away by my wife. And I am apprehensive that other Part B members also may take over without any gesture on my part to cede any autonomy to them. Anyway, this was on a higher plane. It's a wonderful articulation because you have broadly shown that federalism is becoming weaker and weaker, though we call our constitution of a federal nature. That is a real threat to democracy, even. Thank you very much for the insightful talk, Mr. Paramesh.
Thank you, this is Shampuma, sir. Before we open up for discussion, just one doubt lingering. What are the constitutional protections? I mean, is there any safeguards or protections? I mean, I'm not saying that state is supreme or the center is supreme, but the checks and balances, where is it that a balance is struck?
The constitutional protections would have been the institutions themselves, right? The Raj Sabha, for example, the Interstate Council, for example, the judiciary to a large extent. Even so far as the judiciary is concerned, we have almost, let's take a representation of judiciary of states. I counted today morning, there are 5 or 6 states in this country that have never sent a judge to the Supreme Court. There are 4 states until creation of high courts in their own states in the Northeast, never sent a judge to the High Court. So I'm saying these are institutions where only diversity could have enhanced our federal values. So any attempt at diversity in judiciary today is rendered negatory. The constitutional text says the governor shall recommend so far as the High Court judges are there. Where is the office of the governor today in so far as judicial appointments is concerned? So the election commission, for example, one would have thought that the way we worked our constitution, the election commission would have been a much more broader based commission because they are virtually the safekeepers of our democracy, our election process. But the election commission today has become another way to accommodate retired civil servants or about to retire civil servants. So the way in which we work our institutions, according to me, is the primary check and balance on federal powers. If we don't work our institutions properly, the other example I gave was 10 schedule. Today, even if a parliamentarian from Kerala or Tamil Nadu wants to articulate the rights of states, he's completely bound by the party line on it. So if you have the party decisions being dominated by a particular constituency, it does not matter whether the other people think that they are to act on behalf of their states. So institutionally, I think we have lost all protection for federalism in this country. Institutionally. Because it does not matter whether you are in the Raj Sabha, you are always bound by the Raj Sabha. Also, you are always bound by the whip of the party. So there is no way. So until and unless our institutions become responsible to states' powers, I don't think we can work out federal powers in this constitution. So the answer is to sustain institutions. There is no other way.
Absolutely. Even the Supreme Court has started issuing directions to the High Court.
That's true. That's true.
Absolutely. Rao, sir.
So very well put. And the classic example that I can give you because of the state's reorganization is the Polavaram project in Andhra Pradesh. It started in 1940s with the Madras Presidency, where my great-grandfather was a member of the Madras Presidency. And I'm the erstwhile Zamindars of Polavaram. The reorganization of the state, now I have to deal with Chhattisgarh and Telangana. Earlier, it was only Orissa, Andhra Pradesh, and Madhya Pradesh to a little portion where Chhattisgarh was created. And it 1940 till today, the project has not seen the light of the day. We have, because the center doesn't send money, the states can't fund it, and it's languishing right through. And the river Godavari has narrowed down to a stream today, thanks to partial work done at Bhadrachalam. You see, there is, and the other biggest mistake is to distribute the states on a linguistic basis. That has created major problems, heartburns, which is even simmering today. Like this, last week, Maharashtra and Karnataka had Belgaum as an issue. What has happened is, we have not gone beyond I, me, and myself. And that is where this whole problem, like the political class has created so many problems for us. If the constitution was left untouched as it was, maybe it would have done a much better job. As they said, too many cooks spoil the broth, and that's exactly what is happening today. I'm sorry, pardon me, you're all legal numeries. I'm not a legal numery. And Vijay will agree with me because he would see the river Godavari spate that happens at Rajahmundry where he is from. You see, that project has been lingering because had it been left to one particular agency, maybe we would have seen the light of day. What is happening between Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, Kaveri water problem? Because we are not looking beyond our nose. That is the biggest problem. If I'm in power today, I want it concentrated to me only. Everybody should talk to me. Like, and GST is the biggest example today, which you have said. The state have no money today. And the GST today's council says they don't have money to disburse to the states. So what has centralization done for the country? Nothing. And if it's the pet project of somebody, the funds will come in. If it is not a pet project of somebody, then the funds dry up. So basically, this is the biggest drawback was trying to divide. Had we left it as the four presidencies that it was there, maybe we would have got much more out of the country and the states, or in terms of whether it was the forest, whether it was environment, whether it was, the resources from the states. Today, even Kerala, God's own country, there is a lot of resource in that state, but it is not developed because there's an animosity between the center and the state because the different parties are ruling it. So it is basically the political structure which was not envisaged in the constitution. Everything centers around the politician. Today, even a transfer for a constable, a politician decides. The commissioner cannot decide. Latest example is in Bombay. The DGP, they didn't even consult the DGP when they were transferring the police IPS officers. It just went to the minister and it was agreed. We talk of decentralization of power, but actually it is more concentration of power in a particular political hand rather than decentralization. The day you have decentralization, sir, this country will turn around. And what happens is once I'm in the center, I want to conquer all the states. The states don't listen to me, I'll close the tap to that state. So that the basic problem is, as you said, the constitution amendments brought in to get I, me and myself into the picture is what has created this problem today, sir.
Consolidation of power.
Yes. Soul consolidation, sir. Not in like what is happening in Delhi today. Something has happened somewhere else. We are lighting. Can you imagine that one tweet is disturbing the whole country? Have we become that meek and weak that one tweet from some singer from somewhere is going to affect the country? I totally agree. The decentralization has to be there. It has to go back to what the constitution envisaged. That the state would function in the way they were supposed to function. A part of the money would go to the center. Center was supposed to take care of defense and few other subjects. Today, center is deciding everything. It is also going to, tomorrow we might, have the center tell us how many times you can talk in a day or how many webinars you can attend in a day. That it is coming to that today. I'm sorry, Vijay, you're laughing, but is that not what is happening, Vijay? Today, you make one statement on Twitter, you got 10 police cases filed over 10 different states to harass you. There's a misuse of power. So that is what it is. I'm sorry. I don't mean to disrespect anybody. But then these are the facts.
Rouser, it is more or less decentralization of corruption.
Or I would rather say it is centralization of corruption. The money has to go there.
Even that doesn't take place.
Yes, exactly. Even to become a DGP of a state, the money has to go to the center. Like today you find so many IPS officers wanting to leave the state and go back to the center because they're not able to function. They're caught between the center and the state. The latest Maharashtra example is one of the things. We are losing good officers. We're losing honest officers. Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
You have permission.
No, on the issue of stationary organization, I see there are some comments on the chat box. Yes, it's a very tough question as to whether we should have had a reorganization on the basis of language or something else. There's the issue of culture, definitely. There would have been more tensions if we had larger pockets of linguistic minorities in those states. If it had not been on the basis of language, I understand that there are problems in the way in which the reorganization act has worked, but I am not very sure what could have been the other alternative so far as reorganization was concerned, because we couldn't have left the presidencies and the princely states untouched in that sense, because administration would have been a huge task in terms of size, in terms of different cultures there. So yes, the states reorganization on the basis of language is a concern, continues to be a concern. Now that we bring in states reorganization, the other impact on federalism in this country, if you see it from a cultural point of view, is that the Supreme Court is now held through a constitutional bench decision rendered 3 or 4 years back, that a state cannot mandate that it is compulsory for certain children from a certain age group must have instruction only in the mother tongue, which I think is an affront to cultural rights. It is an affront to the state's rights under the Constitution. Having divided states in this country on the basis on linguistic basis, the Supreme Court today tells the states that you cannot by law mandate that primary instructions in primary classes must be on the basis of mother tongue. So I just wanted to point that out when we're talking about the linguistic basis on which the states were divided.
Yes, sir, but like I said, to answer your question, when the princely states were removed and you had merged them into the country as a whole, the division could have been done much better than what it, like Telangana was just created out of a whim and a fancy of somebody. It was not, we had the same, it's not going to, in Maharashtra is going to happen. Vidarbha is going to happen. If not today, tomorrow, Vidarbha is going to happen. Vidarbha is the Telangana of Maharashtra. We're living with it.
I just got another question saying, how do you hold constitutional functionaries to their office? That is a very, very interesting question. I have myself thought about it, obsessively thought about it for a long time. Yes, there is a way. In this country, unfortunately, we have a tradition of only articulating in courts malfeasance. We don't articulate misfeasance. We articulate when something goes wrong, when we can perceive it as discriminatory, when we can perceive it as unreasonable, we go to courts. When people don't take action, we unfortunately don't go to courts. So one way to hold constitutional authorities responsible to the oath that they take, starting with, is to mandate timelines that you render your decisions. Constitutional authorities, whenever they exercise their discretion, must exercise it within a time frame. Now, this is not standard administrative law that I am talking. for example, you see the pardon of this gentleman who accused of killing a prime minister. For the past 6.5 years, we are not able to decide who's to take a call on his pardon. I'm saying, what kind of constitutionalism is there in this country where we can't decide who is to pardon this man? Not whether he should be pardoned or not, but who is to take a decision, we do not know. So one way to bring them, make them responsible is a time frame. The second way to make them responsible is, again, it will get back to, again, standard administrative duty to give reasons. So if a president rejects a bill or a proposed amendment of a state to act in the concurrent list, the president must specify why is he saying that he will not give assent to that bill. For example, as I gave you the example of the Plachimata Compensation Act, the president doesn't give any explanation. He just says that I'm rejecting it. So one way to make them responsible is the duty to give reasons. Three, the other way to enforce constitutional responsibilities on the basis of oath, I think, is to insist that any major policy decision or implementation is only through a legislative body. Because if you are, if decision making, if 70% or 90% of decision making in this country is without an enactment, for example, the Aadhaar, when it started with, did not even have an enactment to support the generation collection and mandatory use of Aadhaar. If it is without a statutory enactment, there is no way that we will be able to enforce any kind of accountability. So I think these three ways, I think, are immediate answers that come to my mind in terms of saddling responsibility on constitutional functionaries.
Taking a cue from what is posted in the chat, is not imposition or insistence for one language for the country against the concept of federalism?
Of course, I have no doubts about that. I have no doubts. That's why we don't have a national language. We only have an official language. The constitutional text only speaks about an official language. Not only that leaves out the most dangerous proposition that I have heard in the recent times to now come about. I left that out. I said the 10th schedule, or the way in which we have made the Raj Sabha irrelevant, how 10th schedule makes you answerable not to your state, not to your voters, but only to what the party wants you to do. The imposition of a one nation, one election puts it in even bigger trouble. So this idea that we must have one nation, one election, I do not know how they will practically work it out. But more than anything, the idea itself is terrifying, because then we are saying, what we are essentially saying is that that only certain agendas will run this country. In the sense that if you have one election, one vote, I'm not saying about the substance of the agenda. I'm saying what will happen is that it's not whether the local issues are important or whether the electors choose their government. And what will happen is that there will be larger agendas which will take
overshadow,
take the call on elections. So you will have national issues that even engine or fuel the local elections, which ideally shouldn't be, because at least for the state elections, we should have the state issues as a predominant reason why we vote X into power or Y into power. So that's the other thing, that's the one nation, one election issues.
I'm sorry. Before I come to Vijay, let us get the question from Advocate Najib TP, please.
Well, we're talking of the Niti Aayog being replaced by the Planning Committee, but then where is the role of the Finance Commission as a statutory body? Another thing was that, you know, that recently an act has come, not recently, in 2003, one act has come, that Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act. And how has that played a role in maintaining the fiscal, federality?
I'm glad that you brought that up. The FRBM Act is, as of today, it's only on the center. It doesn't impose, you have to enact your own, only if the states wish, they can enact their own enactments. But while answering that question, I can point you out to another interesting way in which federalism has worked in this country. I've already stated why I think that taxation powers or revenue generating avenues for the states have come down. Because revenue generating avenues of the states have come down, they have to start borrowing. They have to start borrowing. Now the constitution says you can borrow from people in India, but you can't borrow externally. If you have to borrow externally, you have to take the union's consent. Now, the way in which the union's consent in this country operates is that they will give consent only if this comes with certain conditions. So you can borrow from Japan if it is for drinking water. You can implement those projects. So it comes with certain conditions. Now, what states have started doing, a classical example is Kerala. It realizes it can't ask the union permission before it borrows. So the government will not borrow. So it will not show the borrowings on its book. It will create a public sector entity like the Kerala Infrastructure Development Board, KIDB, make KIDB float those bonds abroad and then borrow money. So which is actually a fraud on the constitution, if you ask me, because what you are essentially doing is that borrowing is not budgeted. So when the minister presents the budget, he will not even list that as a borrowing, but essentially the entire debt through bond borrowing by the KIDB is underwritten by the state. So if the union, I'm not saying that the states are to blame completely for this, if the union were perhaps to exercise financial powers in a more federal setup, in the sense the spirit is more federal in nature, perhaps these occasions wouldn't arise. So the FRBM Act today, as of today, it only if you don't have one for your state, you are not bound by fiscal discipline at all, because the Central Act applies only to the center. So, and the way in which the center also gets around the FRBM Act is by saying making its public sector units borrow. So the debt is not. So this budget, for example, addresses some of these issues. Earlier, the Food Corporation of India used to borrow borrow heavily for the grain intake. So it would never get reflected in the union budget. But this time, the budget addresses that issue. It says it will fund the borrowing, thereby for the first time in about two or three decades, that food procurement is being reflected in the union budget as such. Otherwise, it would only be shown in the books of Food Corporation of India, never in the union budget. So, yes, there are problems, but that was my comment, not an answer.
One more thing, you know, that CSR funding, you know, that there also there finds a lot of dichotomy wherein the Prime Minister's Relief Fund, it's not applicable to the state, I mean, the Chief Minister's Relief.
That's true. The Companies Act, being a central statute, only those avenues listed under the statute are recognized as corporate funding. So unfortunately, not just this, I'm saying, if you see any public sector undertaking, the major ones, the oil corporations in this country, even for that matter, even state-run public sector corporations, all their CSR activities are politically mandated. They are not in that sense. It's not true corporate social responsibility in that sense. It's always dictated by political exigencies.
Political social responsibility.
And Air India is the biggest example. The loan component of 38,000 has now been pushed onto a special purpose vehicle unit created. So when the sale happens, the debt will not be the buyer's responsibility. It will lie with the SPV. And the SPV is directly with the budgeted with the government. So you're indirectly writing off your loans or taken and giving the private seller a cheaper company, and you're offsetting the debts. The government will pay the debts tomorrow. That SPV, how are you going to close it? It is going to be on the books of the SPV. That 38,000 crores is going to become 50,000 crores by next year. And that is one of the reasons why Air India has not been able to be sold. And when the sale was in process, the assets have been monetized and it has disappeared. So even the aircraft that are there with Air India today are only the leased aircrafts.
So, yes. I'm sorry. Please.
Yeah.
Najib, anything more?
No, I just want to find that the distinction between this planning commission and the finance commission, because what is the role of that finance commission right now? The 21 to 26, they have come up with a report. No, how
The 15th finance commission is just to give it final report. Now, the finance commission's constitutional duties are actually devolution of funds. The distribution of funds is the finance commission's responsibility. But as I said again, the finance commission wasn't constitutionally given the power of social and economic planning. So the Nehruvian politics created a planning commission modeled on the Soviet structures of a socialist planning model. Unfortunately, the end goals of devolution are determined by the planning commission, were always determined by the planning commission, thereby indirectly dictating the terms of the finance commission. So the finance commission, which should have been otherwise a very robust organization, a robust institution to articulate the state's concern, was, if you have already decided from the plan commission that for the next 5 years, this is where we are going to spend, then you also determine who's getting what funds. So the finance commission was just to do the arithmetics to fit it into those categories. So the planning commission, I said, is not statutory, not constitutional, but exercised great influence. This must be seen as a package. So the union assumes control over health, union assumes control over agriculture, union assumes complete control over social economic planning. We never challenged it, we never tested it, whether it was constitutional, not constitutional. The union, you have an urban development ministry in the union. Why should an urban development ministry, something that as decentralized as town planning, be with the union? But unfortunately, the way we worked the constitution, not the text, not the judgments, the way we practice constitution, the constitution in this country, we have virtually given away all, the states have virtually given away all those powers to the center. So the plan, the goal, the ends of the planning finance commission are determined, were determined by the planning commission. Unfortunately, the finance commission was only to do with the arithmetic, but not the policy makings. So that's what happened with the finance commission.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Over to you, Vijay.
Thank you, Mr. Parameshwar. You are very articulate in what you are speaking. Very forthright in your views. Thank you. And just a query, are you the guy who knows Mr. Srinivas, M. Srinivas Rao?
Sorry?
Mr. M. Srinivas Rao?
Yeah, we used to do some cases together. That's right. That's right.
Yeah, I've been hearing your name for last 15 years because I'm associated with this office here. Jagannathrao's office, I'm associated because I've been hearing, I know your marriage also. I think Justice Jagannathrao also attended.
Yes, true. I'm the same person.
But he did tell me that. Yeah. good that I'm at least giving a face to the name. See this, just coming to... See, I have no specific queries because federalism is now the political scenario is that we are leading weak states, strong center is a concept that we are going towards. See, the coalition politics more or less have determined this particular line of approach, I guess. Amongst the two parties, it is BJP central government. The coalition one or the Congress led one. This is what we are going towards. And we suppose division of Andhra Pradesh is after a long battle of Telangana people, but it suits the central politics because a state which has got about 42 MPs has now got about half of it. So that's how it is suiting the national politics. Now to answer Mr. KVJ Rao's query with regard to division, because he started with regard to linguistic basis. It all started in Andhra. Andhra is the state to be from the Madras presidency on linguistic basis, 1956, and now the creation of others on linguistic basis. So if anybody should complain, sorry? If anybody should complain, it's not the guys from Andhra that... Sorry?
No, whatever is wrong, Vijay. I'm not saying that what we done was right. I am admitting that. I am admitting that there was a problem. Yeah. We were well off under the Madras presidency. I mean, I have no issues. My family was really well off.
True. And see, most of these legislations, the encroachment, there is this principle of pith and substance saying that, I have not seen a central legislation being struck down on the ground that it encroaches into a state list. Not because this principle of pith and substance, they always have a way of weaving around that particular legislation and saying that it is sustainable and it can be sustained, notwithstanding the fact that it is forming part of the state legislation also. I did not find too much of case law subject to what the people may say. This is what it is. Today we are in an age where federalism is a thing of the past. I think we are futuristically looking, we are more looking at centralized. GST has taken away the economic freedom of various states and it has crippled them and made them dependent on the center. And one good thing or the bad thing about the GST is that we don't hear any kind of separatistic talk that we used to hear early 90s and late in 80s. That is not there. That is not a narrative that we see in any of those political parties. GST has crippled the financial independence of it has reduced the states to like a son of a father who lives on his pocket money. So that's how it is. Thank you, Parameshwar. It was very, very articulate. Now I wish I could hear you a little more.
Thank you. No, I just wanted to make two comments. The power of states constitutionally or legally speaking, de jure, has reduced. But the bigger states in this country continue to flex their muscles. Because of numerical reasons. So even with the GST Council, the not only is the power of a state subjected today to the power of the center, but for example, a Kerala or Tamil Nadu's power is also subject to the voting that Maharashtra or Uttar Pradesh does in the GST Council. So that is the kind of unfortunate mess we have created for ourselves. So what is to be taxed in my state is not only going to be decided by me and the center. I could have still understood that. I could have still comprehended that in the constitutional scheme. But whether I will protect locally manufactured goods, what will I tax them on? Today is also subject to what Maharashtra or Gujarat today will say on what I should tax them. So what I was trying to say is that de jure, yes, the states have reduced power, but the bigger states still retain power because of the political heft they have in terms of numbers in that sense. Because if they have the numbers, then they can influence policy. Today, it is sufficient to influence policy because most of the concerns are today. Social economic planning is policy making, not through legislation. So that way, de facto, the bigger states continue to retain what say they had perhaps even 25, 30 years ago in the affairs of the state. Whereas the smaller states are the ones who have lost. This also points us out towards how we think about the composition of the Lok Sabha itself. If you keep pegging it only on population numbers, what will eventually happen is that the southern states end up contributing per capita higher GDP to the country. But the numerical political strength lays with the three or four bigger states in this country. So that is another tension so far as federalism is concerned in this country. Because what I know, for example, Karnataka has been articulating this for a long time. Very clearly, Chief Minister Siddaramaiah articulated it saying, it can't be that we contribute 16-17% of the GDP. And when it comes to decision making, we are 1/10 or 1/11 of political voice. So that is the other tension that is going to brew in coming days. We will see this happening. We will see this even more stark.
Correct.
The clout of might is right.
Mm-hmm. See, this bigger states continue to extend clout because they are mostly alternatively ruled by the two major political parties. As simple as that. Because they don't have threat of any regional party. Once they have a threat of regional party, they look at dividing the party first. You take it from me.
Okay, a couple of questions.
Because I come from Andhra, I know that how much power we used to wield up center because we are the biggest state before division. know this separatism suited the national politics. That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying that separatism is wrong. Separation, creating of a separate state is wrong, but it suited the national politics. Therefore,
there was another question on the role of, there was another question on the role of union territories in federalism.
Mugunda,
I think that concept of a union territory is outdated. According to me, frankly speaking, the concept of a union territory is outdated. Let's count there. Delhi is almost a state. The other reason for creating union territories were that they were pockets of other European colonial powers. Therefore, we retain them as such. I don't see why we should retain, if we are able to culturally protect French interests in Pondicherry or in Mahé, etc. If we are able to protect their European cultural interests, I don't see why they should why they shouldn't be merged with the state and be governed in that sense. Puducherry has also got a legislature of its own. So these are all almost states, not states yet, but they are almost there. Delhi, Puducherry. The other major union territory worth discussing about is Chandigarh, but that's a political compromise because both states wanted that to be a joint capital. Therefore, it's a political compromise. Otherwise, technically speaking, the union territories do not have a major role in so far as federal relations are concerned. And I think seriously think that's an outdated concept.
Another question from Manisha Maran is, electoral bond also plays a threat to democracy. What is your opinion on it?
Electoral bonds with complete disclosure, I don't see there be a problem. I think we should encourage any form of donations that are reported. If you don't disclose whom it is being bought by, then there is a problem. Otherwise, I think this is much better than having the electoral process being run in cash. It is better if it is run, if it is out in the open. At least, like the Western countries, we will know which industries or which interest group are supporting which political parties. And if we vote those political parties, who will have the say in those political parties' manifestos in their policies? So, to me, bonds as such is not a problem. The question is the anonymity condition that is attached to the bonds. I think that definitely is a cause of concern.
Lack of transparency. Yes.
Dilip sir, anything to be added? Okay. Then over to you, Prem.
Well, that is a wonderful articulation on this federalism. And as you rightly said, our judiciary on quite a few occasions, they have dealt with cases which involves this issue of federal character of the Indian Constitution. But if you closely have a reading of the various judgments, right from 1963, almost all are five judge and seven judge benches. The first one which crowded was in 1963, as you know, in the land acquisition case, that is state of West Bengal was Union of India. Wherein it was first held that, of course, the Constitution is not federal in character. And subsequently, you had two cases. I think it is during 1977-78. One was state of Rajasthan was Union of India, and the other was state of Karnataka was Union of India, which concerned with Article 131 of the Constitution, which you had, in one of the cases you had, in your talk you had said that Justice Bate went on to say that the Constitution, even though it's not truly federal in character, in one sense, it is federal. But to the extent of federalism, it has been largely watered down by the needs of progress and development. But kindly see, whenever we say that federalism, as you rightly put it that federalism itself, now it has been taken to the graveyard. Even though right now I would say federalism, of course, is in the coffin, in the dying stage. But let me ask you one thing. One of the decisions which we cherish is Keshavananda Bharati. And if you closely read the judgment, many of the judgments would say that federalism itself is a part of the basic structure of the constitution, which means that it cannot be tampered with. And this view has been attested subsequently in the SR Bombay case also, where five different judges, like Justice Ahamadi, Justice Kuldeep Singh Ramaswamy, Justice Jeevan Reddy, and Justice Agarwal, all of them attested to this particular view. But subsequently, you can see the recent developments which you cited, like one is the formation of Telangana. Then you have the 100th Amendment to the Constitution, whereby some land was transferred to Bangladesh. Of course, that was a serious threat on the federalistic structure itself. And finally, the introduction of the GST itself. Don't you think that nowadays the parliament, it is going against the basic structure itself, because Keshavananda Bharathi says federalism, it's a basic structure. So it cannot be even tampered with. Don't you feel that if at all these acts are put under challenge, then of course it will be thrown overboard. Why? Because you are tampering the basic structure of the constitution. What is your take on that?
The problem with the basic structure doctrine is that it pegs judicial review onto concepts. It doesn't peg judicial review to specific article or provisions. So if you have to get something struck down as violative of basic structure, you don't yet have a clear definition of what these concepts are. So judicial independence, the court exercises, the only proper, the only manner in which the court has exercised carefully the doctrine of basic structure is on judicial independence. Otherwise, nothing else has been struck down in our constitutional scheme as violative of basic structure until it impacts judicial independence. But if you define judicial independence in a certain way, narrowly or too broadly, then your judicial review parameters also change this. So what I'm trying to say is federalism, democracy, judicial review, judicial independence, etc. are all incoherent in their definition. So if we make India a unitary one nation, one election, can you argue it is violative of federalism? Because they will say, no, because still you are going to elect different governments, federalism is there. If democracy is a basic structure, can you say we can shift from the present system to a presidential form of election, because democracy is still there? So what I'm trying to say is, yes, it looks very nice on paper when we say federalism is a basic structure, but question is, what is federalism? Is federalism the fact that every state must have equal say in the affairs of the country? Is federalism the fact that states' power will not be reduced until and unless the state gives consent? Is federalism that the state will not be split up until the people in the state consent to it? We don't know what federalism is. So even though we say these are basic features of the constitution or basic structure of the constitution, ultimately, how the judge who is going to decide whether basic structure has been violated defines these will be the proof of the eating of the pudding. No, it's not just what you say the pudding is. How you eat it depends on that. So if you ask me, there cannot be a concept of one state, one nation, one election in this country, because it violates federalism. But it's equally possible to argue that so long you elect two governments in that process through that one election, one for the state and one for the center, you could easily argue that it is also federalism, because you're still electing a state government. The state is anywhere on, you're getting an opportunity to have a representation in the state itself. So it is not sufficient to say federalism is basic structure. You have to tell me, to me, you have to identify what part of federalism is inalienable to our country that we cannot give up on. So the thought is that, the thought is not, I am not disputing federalism as basic structure or not. I am saying tell me how to define federalism. And that's where the problem comes. You have to tell me what are the features of that federalism.
See,
that's
manifestation.
The manifestation. Manifestation of federalism.
Because that is where the danger also creeps in. You cannot say that India is federal. That's why absolutely you are terming it as a quasi-federal. There are features of some federalism in our constitution. At the same time, if you ask, is India federal? It is not. But if you ask, is it not? You can say, it is yes. There are certain features. See, that is why it's not treated as a federation. It has not been termed as a federation.
So, what according to you is one of the features? So, to me, then there is no help from the basic structure doctrine. There is no help that comes forth from the basic structure doctrine. Until then, I argue that there are certain states' rights. Forget whether you call it federalism or quasi-federalism. As I said, you call it asymmetrical federalism. I don't care. I started my talk by saying that I'm not concerned with the nomenclature.
I talk with this. Could you kindly tell me whether Indian federalism, whether it is asymmetric or not? What is the kind of federalism which India is having, according to you?
According to me, asymmetric is one of the ways in which you can describe the Indian federalism. You can describe it as asymmetric because traditionally scholars have understood asymmetric federalism. People who have defined asymmetric federalism say it is the imbalance of power in the constituting units or the imbalance of bargaining power, unequal bargaining power in the constituting units that gives its asymmetrical nature. So if that is the definition of asymmetrical federalism, yes, it is. It is asymmetric because the different constituting units in this country have different bargaining power with respect to the center.
At the same time, let me just interrupt and tell you one thing. The term federalism, does it have an apt definition? Because we have various definitions, right from the Australian scholar, I think it's Murray. Different scholars have defined this particular term in different manners. And of course, on one hand, we have articles 246, 250, 52, everything which was deliberated prior to the constitution being adopted. But still, if you see even 246, as Vijay said, the thing is that if a state law comes in opposition with the center's law, it has to fall. Because
Premraj, I agree with you. I started by saying that I don't want to I don't want to keep these concepts in watertight compartments. Because I don't have another name for federalism, I have to talk about these as issues of federalism. If you ask me, I rather talk them about as rights of states. But then do we recognize rights of states in the constitution is another question. So, I agree with you, but all I am saying is that by merely saying that federalism is a basic structure, we do not have a definition of federalism. Therefore, what I say is federalism is equally true of what you say is federalism. So, it won't help. It won't help until and unless our Supreme Court understands that the problem with the basic structure doctrine is incoherent nature. Some people will say that that's the advantage. The advantage of a basic structure doctrine is that it is incoherent. It can be used for X purpose today, tomorrow. It can be used for Y purpose today, tomorrow. But until and unless, so perhaps it is easier to talk about it in terms of autonomy and states' rights. The moment it affects my rights or reduces my autonomy within the existing parameters of the Constitution, I think then we can start talking in terms of states' rights and federalism. Otherwise, the concept itself is a very vague concept in that sense.
Anyway, thank you so much. It was a wonderful talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you
very much. As we come to the end of the 177th session of Legal Empowerment through Interaction Lecture Series, we profusely thank Paramesh sir for that wonderful articulation and presentation on this highly debatable and maybe to a certain extent a misunderstood concept of federalism. As we used to say, unity in diversity, but the diversity also has to be respected for the unity to stand. So, thank you, Ramkumar sir, for your valuable presence and input. And Amit, of course, in absentia, because he just sent a message that he has to leave to go to the church. So, for introducing the wonderful speaker and all of you wonderful participants for the active participation. In our next session, in the 178th session, next Saturday, we are having Justice K.R. Sriram of the Bombay High Court. He'll be dealing with the topic, marine insurance. So friends, thank you, Parameshwar ji, once again. And till we meet again next Saturday, do take care. Stay safe.